My name is Mark Brett. I'm an architect at Salesforce. I have been with Salesforce Search for the last 7 years. I work from the Grenoble office in France. And before that, I was also working on search engine in other company. So let's start with the opening joke. This is a mandatory Salesforce legal agreement because I will show you some part of the product. So basically, you should not make any Salesforce purchasing decision based on the content of this talk. So what we will talk about today? So natural language search at Salesforce. You will see that the context of Salesforce is very specific because our products serve a huge number of customers. More than 150,000 organizations use Salesforce. And this is why I chose the Babel Tower image on the left. Each of these organizations, each of these customers have their own data, their own way to describe their data, and their own meaning for generic terms. And so to address the problem, we built our system with a deep learning model at its core. And it comes with its own challenges because of our very strict legal and technical constraints. Basically, we cannot train on customer data. So let's first explain what is natural language search in the context of Salesforce. So for those who don't know Salesforce, Salesforce provides products for enterprise spanning a wide range of services, sales, marketing, customer support, and so on. It's a subscription-based system, and there is a lot of tenants, as I said, we have a very strict tenant isolation. For search, we have to support many use cases because there are many user experience and many records types, and also it's a platform, so it's heavily customized. So what is natural language search? So with keyword search, if I search for Salesforce cases, as an example, I will retrieve the document that contains those exact terms or potentially variation. But with natural language search, we map the query words to symbols like person, organization, time expression, and so on. So on the left, you have an example. We recognize concept. There are four different concepts. And then we map that to a SQL. And in the case of Salesforce query language, which is an abstraction on top of SQL. So this is the basic principle. Let's look at a bunch of examples. So new leads in SF. So this looks simple. I chose it explicitly to be simple because it's not so simple. Here, the term new maps to custom values inside the organization metadata. Another simple example, here Coca-Cola is customer data. It may mean one in dozens of accounts for this organization. And even my can have different meaning for different companies. Here is another example with a variation of syntax. And last example, with a very short and very few context in this query, accounts CA means accounts in California. So in our system, understanding natural language is not enough. We also need the user to discover what he can ask. So this is where we have query suggestion. So as the user starts typing, we suggest queries. So here, as a user type ACM, the system will suggest Acme technology opportunities and other examples. The system display results, and it also explains what it understood. This is how we fail gracefully. It allows the user to correct this interpretation. So this system is more than just natural language search, actually. It's really a conversation. Now that we saw what we meant by natural language search, let's look at the unique challenge we have at Salesforce. Scale. Salesforce search is based on the Solr search engine. It's one of the largest enterprise search system. And you can see a few numbers I put here. It's really massive. So why I stress that out in the context of this talk is that when we introduce natural language search, we had to meet that bar in terms of scale and performance, because each query that goes through this search input box has also to be parsed by our natural language system. Second, Salesforce is a highly customizable platform. So out of the box, we provide a standard CRM object like account contact, opportunity, support cases. But a customer can also create his own. So you can create your own record type. You can define your own field on the standard object or custom object. You can even rename the standard object and the standard field. So if you don't like accounts, and maybe your company deals with hospitals, you can rename accounts to hospitals. And we have to support that in natural language, of course. You can also create custom enumeration associated to a field. This is what we call pick list. And so in production, we have a wide variety of structure and object that we have to support. On the right, there is an example of the kind of mat data that we have. It's from one of our internal instance. And so this kind of this is the type of vocabulary that we have to support with our natural language queries. Another big constraint is security. Security, we have a lot of security rules, and customers can also define their own. So some records are not accessible to every user. So when we suggest queries, for example, we have to make sure that the user has access to the record that are part of the suggestions. Some fields may not be accessible to all users, or even some record type are not accessible. So for example, cases may not be accessible to a salesperson. So there are some concepts that we cannot expose or even hint that they could exist in the system. And finally, applying natural language to queries is a bit different than fully formed sentence, because there is much more ambiguity and much less context. So here you have, we have short queries with very few context. So here Cisco may mean many different objects. We have competing entities. So if you have Mike Davis accounts, Mike Davis can be a user who owns the account, or it can be the name of a company. And we can also have different interpretations for different concepts. So typically, the concept of ownership, when you have my account can be represented and meaning the account you are assigned to. Your name is in the owner field of this account, but it can also mean my team. It can mean my territory, and because of customization, it can be any field or structure that the customer have decided to use. So now that we saw the challenge, let's see how we solve that problem. At the core of our solution is a deep learning named entity recognition model. So NER for short. So what does NER do? Given a text, in our case, it's a query. It tags each word with a semantic tag. So here in this example, the system tagged six different concepts. So you have the concept of pick list, the concept of person, location, time, and so on. Our deep learning, and so we have a deep learning implementation of a NER system. Our deep learning system is based on AnnaGo, an open source library. It is a TensorFlow model with a standard architecture called by LSTM. So we started with such a rich system. It was useful because it can recognize a lot of concepts. with a single component. So not a lot of moving pieces. And so it was quick to come up with a system that you can pilot with a few customer money. That's what we did. But the main challenge with such a deep learning system is that you need to have a ton of query to train. So we are talking here about millions of queries. And so this was a problem because we cannot use our customer data to build the training set. So to get started, we created a probabilistic grammar that describes the kind of queries that we want to support with the system. And in that grammar, we injected some real data. So we have a mix of synthetics and real data in our training set. And so we injected real data, things like your company name, person name, pick list, locations. And these data came from ever public data set or from our internal system. So as you may know, in a machine learning production system, the model itself is actually a tiny piece of the architecture. You need a ton of plumbing to make the whole pipeline work. And this is what I try to represent in this diagram, but it's also a small part of the architecture because it's only the serving part. And so you can see here that beside the NER model, we also have steps to generate semantic trees. I'll come back to that. Another called resolution to ID. And finally, the executor generates different types of interpretations. The semantic tree. So the NER output a list of entities, but there is no structure. And so this list of tags we got from NER, it is transformed into a tree where a record type is a root of the tree. And we fold the parent child relation. So here you have an example. Here we group the time concept last quarter with a time qualifier that corresponds to a field close date in our data structure. And so during this step, we can also generate multiple alternatives. So we also have some ranking mechanism to rank them. Once you have a semantic tree, we need to apply resolution to ID because some concepts like pick list and person and organization have to be mapped to actual database value. So in particular, person and company, which we still have as words at this step, tagged but still words, need to be resolved to their record ID. And depending on the user, we have personalization and the same words may correspond to different records. So resolution to ID is basically a ranking problem. So we reused our search infrastructure to find the best record that match. And basically it's a solar search scoped to a few record type, that has been determined by the NER model. And we apply two ranking models on top of it. So first one is what we call entity prediction. It orders the record type. It's a model that ranks the record types. And another one orders the records themselves according to a personalized user feature. So basically based on the past interaction of the user with the system, we learn features that are used in this model. Those two models existed before and we reuse them and we tweak them for natural language. Once we have a semantic tree, once we have done resolution to ID, we have a semantic tree whose leaves are resolved. So it means that each field is resolved, the records are resolved to IDs. And so we can now apply security rules. And so some semantic trees are not visible to the user because they don't have access to any part of it or some part of it. And this tree can be mapped without ambiguity to different representations. So it can be mapped to a database query. That's our first goal. But it can also be mapped, as I shown in the screenshot before, it can be mapped to a user-friendly message or to UI filters. And the same tree can be mapped to all those representations. So this was our first model, our first algorithm. And so it was very useful, and we deployed to several customers. But we saw some limitation. First, there was some confusion between a pick list and concept symbols like person, company. The second limitation is that we could not inject custom metadata into that model. So again, the example where a customer rename an entity account into hospitals, we don't know at training time. And so we could not train the model to deal with that. So what we did is that we extended the system with what we call pre-tagger. So some part of the intelligence have been moved out of the deep learning model. And so we have pre-tagger for things like custom pick list or for things like custom names. And these pre-tagger are really simple engineering trick like a grammar or regexp. In the case of pick list, it's a simple lookup in an inverted index in memory that contains the customer metadata. And because we have all those pre-tagger, and those pre-tagger may be wrong, and there is some probability associated to it, we also add some ranking mechanism, and we have to rank the different interpretations. I didn't talk so far about how we evaluate the system. And I have only two slides about it, but really we spent a lot of time on that. It's really a critical piece. As you may know, machine learning models are typically evaluated by having a data set split into training, test, validation. In our case, we not only need to evaluate the NER model, but the full pipeline, because our system has actually multiple intelligent parts, the pre-tagger, the resolution to ID. And you also want to exercise the full pipeline. So we started by building a validation data set, and it contained a mix of synthetic data set and manual queries. And more queries are added as we support new concepts and also when we find issue with queries in production. So this is a living data set. And because it is a living data set, we had to build some lifecycle tool to pretty complex because you both want a stable baseline to compare if your model improve, but you want also to see how good you are with the new concept. So for every change that we want to deploy, we go through an evaluation pipeline. It starts with a non-regression suite and offline evaluation. And the next step and the most important one is to evaluate end-to-end using real production data. So for that, we have a sandbox, which is a copy of one of our internal production instance, our own. And so this is the first step. And finally, we have support for A/B experiment. And we have a set of production metrics that we track in production, like adoption or the click-through rate on the natural language search results. And finally, we only briefly talk about query suggestion. I won't give too much detail about the algorithm, but it's really essential for feature discovery. Concepts that are not exposed in query suggestion are barely used by the user. Because they are not familiar with those concepts, they don't know if it exists. And even today, we have a big adoption of these features. The majority of natural language search queries, they come from suggestion. So very quickly, our query suggestion is based on an in-memory grammar. It's a subset of the training dataset grammar. And we use Solr autocomplete query to resolve records. And that's it. I'm done. So just to recap, I presented the natural language search system that we deploy as part of Salesforce. I have a link here that if you want to know, to learn more about the product. We started with a deep learning model, and because we needed to support many customization scenarios and to meet the quality bar of our product, it grew more complex with WooSpreadTagger, with full validation pipeline, and so on. That's it. Thank you. I'm ready for questions.
Thank you, Mark. Thanks for your talk. Right now, there are no questions over. Oh, someone is typing. There are no questions over on Slack for the moment. As we run a bit over time from the previous delay, I would suggest that we, I think after this one question, move over to the breakout room, the Jitsi room, and then people can directly interact and ask their questions to you.
Sure.
So there is one question right now. Someone is asking, is there a way to get feedback based on user interactions and update the model?
So yes, as I show, we have what we call a remediation in one of the screenshots. We present to the user two things. We allow him to change part of the query that we understood. So you can, if we understood that Mike Davis is a user, we allow you to say that this is not a user. Actually, this is Mike Davis Incorporated, which is a company. So the user can correct. The other mechanism is the user can revert to keyword search if this was actually not a natural language query. So those are the main direct feedback mechanism that we have. The other feedback is that we monitor all that. We look at production to check where we fail. And so we have a fairly extensive feedback from our monitoring system. And so the question I didn't answer on the update the model part. Basically, we update the model. Right now, we update the model kind of manually, semi-manually, in the sense that we add more test set in the training dataset. So we add more structure of things that we see in production. So there are some for example, initially, we didn't support something like show me my account. So this is the kind of structure that we add to the training. How often is the model updated? Right now, we ship a model every 2 weeks. So it's week or 2 weeks.
Okay. Thank you very much for your talk, Mark. I think we all enjoyed it. And now we can move over to the Jitsi breakout room. And we'll see you there for more questions. Thanks.
Thank you. Thanks, everyone.